Aparna, you've been directing films for nearly 40 years.
Yeah, it's amazing, you know, I just feel so blessed.
You've made 12 films since your wonderful first film, 36 Charungile.
Yeah.
Tell me what has changed.
What has changed? Well, you know, I think one of the wonderful things that has changed is that nowadays, even in the mainstream space, we're getting different kind of cinema now, and people are beginning to accept different kind of stories. Maybe it's a result of globalization and, you know, them watching all kinds of films on television. But you know what happens, Rajeev, in spite of all that, another kind of formula creeps in.
Right.
So that I don't think will ever change, because people are just too scared not to not to do that, because they want to make money. Which is why I say I'm blessed, because, you know, I'm very surprised that making the kind of films I make, people will still stick their necks out and offer to make films with me.
Does
I still
it not
get producers.
Get easier with time?
No, not at all. Not at all. My best producer was my first, Shashi Kapoor.
Of course. I was going to ask you, what are your memories of making 36 Charungile? Of course, Shashi Kapoor was your producer. You won the National Award for Best Director. It really is a film that still has this enduring quality to it. What are your memories?
Memories, though, one of the memories is that everything, you know, there are some films where everything happens easily.
Yeah.
It was my first film. I sailed through it. Shashi said, "Wo ta haste haste film bana rahi hai, baad mein roegi." Which is true. There are some films that have given me a lot of trouble. Memories of 36 are, one of the memories that I have is coming here to Bombay to shoot the dream sequence.
Mm.
And, you know, we came, Shashi said, "Kya kya chahiye aapko?" For going out and looking at the location.
Yeah.
I said, I need the art director with me, I need my assistant with me, I need my cameraman with me, and maybe a videograph. She said, "Do production ke aadmi bhi de rahe hain." I said, "Wo kya zarurat hai?" Not knowing the first thing.
Think about, right.
Yeah. And then we go there, and I find, when we go there, I find that the whole thing has changed. You know, everything has changed. He's got tent set up, a bathroom for women, bathroom for men. I mean, I don't think anybody sort of does it that well as Shashi does. Wonderful.
Are you in touch? Are you in touch with Shashi Kapoor at all?
Yeah, well, I do sometimes when I come to Bombay for a little longer. Like we, you know, Kunal Kapoor has restored.
That's right.
36 Charungile.
Right.
And I come sometimes for Prithvi events.
Right.
And then I do try to see Shashi, but then I don't know if Shashi recognizes me anymore. He smiles sweetly.
Aparnadi, when you think of yourself, do you think of yourself as a director or as an actor? I mean, you've done incredible work as both, and often in the same film.
Well, I think of myself as a director, actually. It's, you know, sometimes I do have to work in my own films. It's much easier acting in other people's films.
Sure.
I don't like acting in my own films because I don't get the benefit of my own supervision.
Of course.
So, I have an acting coach who's very good. But even so, you know, it's very difficult to always be aware of what's happening over there and still concentrate on your character, go into its depths. It's very difficult. I don't know how people like Orson Welles or Guru Dutt or people like that. I don't know how they did it.
Petni, shark chutney.
Garnish chicken here, all right.
Macroman series.
Only in their briefs. I wonder who gets to bet them.
Not so loud. Someone might hear you.
Here.
Oh, not on me. I like the smell of my man.
In your new film, Sonata, it is, of course, the story of these two women, this incredible friendship between these two women, a Bengali and a UPite.
And three, actually.
Yeah, there are other characters. Lilette is a very key character in that film. But I feel like it's really it's a story of these two women. Also, what I really enjoyed about it, I have to say, is just the authenticity of that relationship. How real they felt. They were not, and you as a filmmaker were not afraid of showing them as cruel, hurtful, sarcastic, mean to each other, because it was all steeped in an abiding love and affection for each other. What drew you to this play,
subject,
and
this play.
And why was Shabana Azmi your perfect co-star for this?
Well, you know, the thing is that when I'd seen this play as a stage production years ago, I felt very drawn to it because I felt that, you know, during this 1.5 hour duration with just three characters, basically, three major characters, it didn't flag for a second. It doesn't, you know, there's such a rich interplay of moods and such wonderful scope for acting.
Sure.
It's a performance-oriented chamber piece, actually. It's a chamber piece.
Right.
So, I thought it might work very well, very well. Particularly for a small budget film, because then you have it in one location, no? And not that many characters. And I would have the chance to work with actresses that I had admired for a very long time.
Yeah.
Shabana and Lilette are two actors that I've really admired. Shabana I've worked with before.
Of course.
But Lilette, this is the first time, and I have to say that I was very, very, very taken with her performance. Very good. And you were saying about why Shabana was the choice.
Yeah.
Really, Shabana was the choice because, first of all, she insists on being in all my films.
Right.
She can. And secondly, you know, she sings so well. I didn't want playback.
Right.
Because my films are seen internationally also. And so when we have playback, the baggage that is carried is of mainstream cinema.
Right, right.
And that audiences there don't seem to like. So I try to avoid that. In this film particularly. And you know, she is a woman in her 60s or late 50s or whatever. And she doesn't have to have a flawless voice.
Right, right.
But Shivana was pretty much flawless. Actually, she's very good.
Akash kandhi hota shu. I sway through life with abandon.
What tempted you to not play the rebellious Bengali and to play the, as they describe her, the stuck-up, prudish UPI?
Prudish UPI. No, because I can't sing. I can't sing a note. I can't carry a tune.
That was the one single reason?
No, I think that I don't know. I thought Shabana had brought to it a sparkle, champagne-like sparkle to that character.
She
and
does.
Such a delicious character. And I knew that I could depend on Shabana to just let her hair down and let go.
Right. What was for you the challenge in playing the other character?
Well, you know what?
Arun?
Aruna. Aruna is... I found it very difficult to get the Bengaliness out of me.
Right. Right.
Well, I can't do anything about my looks. It's
sure.
the way I look. But then... you know, what I tried was, in English, Bengalis have a softer way of speaking English.
Mm.
I tried to use hard consonants.
Right.
I tried to do that.
Right.
Like more, failure, you know, that kind of thing. Because I've noticed a lot of people from UP speaking like that. I'm not saying all UPIs speak like that. But I've noticed a lot of people speaking like that.
I could be completely wrong, but she seems so unlike you.
Yeah.
You know, just... narrow-minded, prudish.
Well, she's not narrow-minded because she's quite, she gives her jewelry for that, the operations for that transgender friend of hers.
Yeah, yeah.
She's not narrow-minded that way, but she's very reserved.
Right.
She's very, she doesn't like anything showy.
Mm.
She can't express herself. She can't, she's very wary of touching and that kind of thing. And it comes from a Chaturvedi Brahmin upbringing, so...
Right. What was it like working with these actresses? Was it a pleasurable experience making this movie, shooting this film?
Oh, yeah. You know, Lilette has said to me, and I feel wonderful about it, she said, you know, the best compliment I can pay you is that I felt that we were in a play.
That's lovely, yeah.
Because all of us have this common theatre background.
Yeah, yeah.
So we shot this film in the shooting was done in the spirit of theatre in a very democratic way, you know. No stars, wars, nothing like that. And, you know, we were shooting 12-hour days. So, but it was like hard work, but very enjoyable hard work.
You know, you're one of the great filmmakers of our times, Aparna. Is there a sense of, I mean, do you resent the fact that for 40 years nearly, the approach has to be an indie approach to making movies? Do you, you know, as you said, it doesn't get any easier. Do you kind of, do you feel bad about that? That it doesn't get any easier?
No, it doesn't. I know. I mean, people, there's always lip service. Oh, you're such a great filmmaker. Oh, ma'am, it's such an honor. But I suppose I should feel grateful, actually, because, so many years after 36 Chorangile in 1981, this is 2017, I still get producers to come and ask me to make films for them.
True.
Low budget, but then that is something that I've accepted as a choice that I've made.
Of course.
You can't make these films on a big budget. Mm. The moment you do, stars will be needed. Mm. And then the ball game changes, do this thing, otherwise we won't make money. Make this compromise, make that compromise. Mm. Very few producers will have complete faith in you and when you go in for a slightly bigger budget.
Sure.
I've had that in Bengal though, I must say.
Right. You've had the opportunity to work with some of the great directors as an actor, of course, with Ray, with Rituporno. What do you feel is the quality, Aparnadi, that all great directors have?
Well, I think one of the things that they have to have is that they have to be able to hang on to their vision against all odds.
Mm.
Because filmmaking is a thing where there's so many variables
that
you're under tremendous pressure. Mm. And that you have to literally guard your vision like a lamp, and let it not be blown out or buffeted, because it will be buffeted, but it should not get blown away.
Mm.
That is very, very difficult and very important.
What do you think of yourself as a director?
I don't know. It's so difficult.
Are you able to be objective
about
your work once it's done?
I always hate it.
And always? Or some distance and some time allows you to become objective?
Yeah, maybe. Some of my films I can see now many years later, maybe not see that many mistakes. Or at least even if there are mistakes, the film has still risen above the mistakes. Like 36 Chorangile. Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, I just see mistakes. But I know that it has risen above those mistakes. The Japanese Wife, I'm quite the most satisfied with. You never feel satisfied with any film.
Right.
But the most satisfied with was probably The Japanese Wife. And some Bengali films that I've made.
Dear E.
Dear S.
I am wanting you to make love to you under the stars. And under the moon. Under the sun, under the roof. Oof.
My goodness.
Your daughter, Konkana, has now directed her first film.
Yeah.
And it's such a lovely film, A Death in the Ganj. Do you look at that work and see yourself? Do you feel like, do you see your influence? Do you...
Well, yes, in a way. Because, you were asking me just now, what is the quality that all good directors have to have? I think one other quality that they have to have is being able to see the film very clearly in their heads.
Yes.
This Konkana was able to do. I mean, when I first heard her script, I thought, oh my God, she really has all the imagery worked out in her head, She can see how she wants it.
Mm.
In fact, my piece of advice to her was that don't get wedded too much to it, because, there will be things that will happen that will not allow you to reach exactly those images. And you have to think on your feet.
Right.
That's also something you have to do.
True.
You have to think on your feet all the time. Okay, I won't be able to get this. The sun is... let me try to... You have to do that. But then you learn that along the way. I think Konkana is a very self-assured director. That's her first film. I mean, it's amazingly sensitive and self-assured. Yeah.
You find increasingly that there are such few good roles for women who are above a certain age. And then something like Sonata comes along and you feel like, wow, there are, it may be in the indie space, it may be in an English film, but there are these great opportunities. Was that something that, do you feel strongly about that?
I want to say something else before that, Rajeev. There is, I think that English films, why do people not want to make more English films?
Sure.
Because it's not, I don't think that's, it's only the indie space.
Mm.
I think that English is very much an Indian language.
Of course.
We all speak in English. The diversity of languages, the diversity of culture, all of that.
Mm.
We have to choose some language to speak in.
Right.
Either it's got to be Hindi. Not everyone can speak Hindi well. Not everyone can speak English well. So it's, and the language develops like a river.
Right.
So it is still in the process of development. It always will be in a state of flux. But having said that, I really feel that, I've never thought about this. Because even my first film was about an old woman.
Of course, right.
But I don't underestimate my audiences. Mm.
But you've created some of those opportunities, even for other actresses.
Yeah.
Whether it's Debashree Roy, whether all of them. I mean, you create for yourself, of course. But it's hard to find, especially in Bombay.
Well, you know, what happens is that you don't... I think that if you don't underestimate your audience, if you're telling a human story and you're able to touch some chords within the viewer,
yeah,
then, you know, why should they... I love Miss Tonam. Why won't they love Miss Tonam?
Right.
I love Dolon and Subi,
right,
these friends of mine in Sonata. Why won't the audience love them? It doesn't strike me, you know?
Sure.
And that's a blessing.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't have to think about, oh God, will... And get scared at every step.
Right.
Because if you get scared, then you really can't put your heart and soul into making the film.
Right.
If you're terrified of the audience, oh God, will they accept this? Oh God, will they accept that? Why should I be terrified of my audiences? I love them and I hope they love me back.
Do you have memories when you come to Bombay? I know the trips are not as frequent as perhaps you like it to be. You have a little grandson now.
Yes, yes.
Do you have memories of working here, the little bit of work that you did here as an actor?
I used to have a whale of a time. I mean, I think the most enjoyable thing about my stint in Bombay was actually outside of the studio. It was like going for long walks on the beach with friends and, you know, drinking wine and just hanging out with friends, shopping and, you know, that kind of thing. More that kind of thing. Going to see plays.
Do you have enduring friendships with film people?
Yes, with film people. I have enduring friendships. This is the thing.
Mm.
And I think... for instance, you asked me about with film people, with Shabana.
Mm.
I have been friends since Sati, which was made in what, ages ago. And it's just endured.
Mm.
You know, this is what I'm saying. Women make wonderful friends for women, unlike the popular misconception that women don't like each other. I think when they're very young, maybe at least earlier on in my generation, they used to compete for the attentions of men.
Right.
Now they're more like to hell with it. You know, and they really bond. I see Konkona bonding with her friends.
That's right.
Konkona's friends even bond with me.
Nice.
They love me.
Of course.
And I love them back. So it's wonderful.
I want to ask you about your view on censorship. It's such a prickly issue today. And I'm not sure your own film faced that.
No, the censors apparently loved it and gave it an uncut A. See, we were not, obviously it's an A. I mean, we don't expect children to go and see this.
Sure.
But I'm very unhappy about the fact that they didn't certify Alankrita's film, Lipstick Under My Burqa. Do we really need a board of certification? Because if they don't certify a film, then what happens?
Mm.
If why don't they say, okay, this is AA or AAA, and leave it?
There needs to be a widening of the categories.
Yeah, I mean, how can they not certify a film unless that film is provoking people, deliberately inciting them to riots or something like that. That's different. But I don't think... and you know what they say nowadays is that this kind of thing will be insightful. It'll incite people. It'll incite people meaning what? You're predicting that it'll incite people to violence or whatever. So deal with it. That's a law and order problem.
Right.
Why must you... make an infringement on the right to expression, of freedom of expression.
What do you believe is the way forward as a filmmaker, as a creative person?
You know, I found something very interesting. I've never used censorship on my daughters. And you know, I've been a film society child.
Yes.
So, I've never used it. I took them to see what Cries and Whispers when they were something like 10 and 12. Not 10 and 12. My elder daughter was 12 and the other one was Swan. So, Konkona I took to when I was on the jury in Moscow.
Mm.
And she was all of 10. You know, when she used to get bored with very sort of, very scenes that were very intimate or bed scenes, etc. she would yawn, turn her back to the screen and go to sleep. So I have found that this is what happens.
Right.
You know, you let them be exposed, then they get bored with it. How long will they enjoy that kind of thing? Only one thing, there was this about the nuclear holocaust, you know, there was a bit about Japan in a film called Black Rain, very well-known film. And she saw this father losing his child in a fire, and she turned to me and she said, if I were in that fire, would you go and save me? And I said, yes. Because I knew that she needed to be reassured.
Right, right.
But that's about it,
that's
you know.
That's the extent to which she was disturbed, right.
If it affects them. It doesn't affect them if they see people kissing or, you know, even petting or whatever. I don't think it affects them much.
Does it make you cynical about where things are headed if this is the manner in which the sensor board operates?
Yeah, it does. I'm worried about the various kinds of censorship, not only in the Board of Film Certification, but the various kinds of censorship that are insidiously creeping up and choking the voice of, you know, free expression. I'm worried about that, very worried. I think the climate, the political climate that, or religious climate or whatever it is, needs to be a freer climate, a free of religious fundamentalism of any kind. And I'm, you know, I've said this before and I'm saying it again, it is there within both the two most important religions in our country, I mean, Hinduism and Islam. You have Sufism, which right. embraces everybody.
Right.
In Hinduism, you have Advaitavad, which doesn't differentiate between yourself and the other. So why?
Right.
You don't have to import it from anywhere. Mm. It's there.
What do you feel about the state of Indian films, of Indian cinema?
Well, as I said, Indian films, I think that there has been an interesting and exciting change in that there are many new subjects that are being explored, and less of formula subjects. But having said that, I also feel that the formula part creeps in the predictability of the way stories are panned out. You know, they are very scared of not having songs, or even if they're background songs, but or they will have a laugh-a line in order to get through, and they're terrified, as I said before, terrified of the audience. But you do have films like Masand, you do have films like Aligarh, I haven't seen Lipstick Under My Burqa, but it has been made. You have Angry Young Goddesses or whatever.
Right.
You know, you have so many films now that are different, which I like. I like that they are doing that.
Do you ever wonder, had you had great success as a Hindi film actress, where your career and life might have gone? Or was that something that just never interested you?
No. I mean, I wanted to establish myself as an actor, but I really wanted to work in Bengal because that was where my family was.
Mm.
And I felt like a fish out of water over here because I couldn't speak the language very well. I mean, I was always fumbling with the grammar. And so I felt that I was not able to give my best as an actor. But I think even if I had been a success, somewhere deep down the exposure in my childhood to world cinema,
right,
that had formed already by the time I came, that had already formed,
of course,
my idea of what I liked in cinema and what I didn't. And I would have probably acted in mainstream cinema because otherwise you can't have a career.
Yeah.
But I think I would have continued to watch good films, and I probably would have, just like Coco, I would have probably started directing, because after a point I sort of got very claustrophobic. I said, I want to get out of this.
Do you find yourself constantly making sure that what you want to say is relevant, that it appeals to a younger audience? Because it seems like everything is kind of geared towards a younger audience. That is
everything. The world today is a place for the young. But then I have no problem with that because I don't feel old.
Right.
You know, I don't feel old in my mind. My body has to age, but I don't feel old in my mind. I'm perfectly comfortable with my daughter's friends.
Yeah.
I think I'll be comfortable with my grandchildren's friends also.
I'm sure.
But that's the thing, you know. It is a world for young people. And I'm glad of that. I mean, I'm not one of those people, in our time, I don't like people like that. I don't like people like that. I'm very, very fascinated by what's happening today and so on. But I also feel that the young people are more sensitive and more geared towards things that are good than we give them credit for.
Mm.
We always think that all they want is, you know, having this kind of very loud music and going to discotheques and so on. But I don't think they're all like that at all.
True.
You know, you give them a chance.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Aparna. It's always a pleasure chatting with you. But also watching your films, you are such a keen observer of the human condition. Always a pleasure, always a joy. Thank you so much. Always a pleasure.